Welcome once again to Super Connectivity. I'm your host, Charlie, the Professor Esther, and with me as always is...
Phil me and Perch.
Hey, Phil. Welcome once again to Super Connectivity. We've had a couple of long episodes because, of course, we have an hour long with Jim Zub, which posted today, which was Friday, St. Patrick's Day, March 17th. 3/17/17. We also just wrapped up a very long, marvelous round. Marvelous World's Most Marvelous Comics, an amalgam special over at World's Finest on DC Books, and of course, we just finished a super long Marvel roundup. Even though I only had four books, I don't know why it went so long, but it did, because I think we talked politics. So let's try to keep the politics to a minimum, Phil.
Yeah, because I'm the problem. Okay.
Clearly. I don't know, man. You inspire me in some way. See, that's why we make a good good team, Phil, because you'll thaw something out there, and I'll go for like an hour, and you can go, you know, chill out with a margarita while I'm yammering.
I toss out those underhand pitches, and he puts them over the fence, people.
Right over the fence, yes. So let's talk about what's going on in the Marvel Universe today. First thing I want to do, a big shout-out to my favorite show DC does, Powerless. Not this last episode, which was a little weak, but the episode before that about Sinking Day, in which they do call out the fact that Atlanteans don't necessarily have the same approaches to the world as the rest of us, because we found out that Ron Funches is actually Atlantean, because they had all the, you know, the blonde-haired, blue-eyed Atlantean execs come in, and but of course when Ron says, "You mean because I'm Atlantean?" and they say, "Wait, you're Atlantean?" This is of course a reference to the fact that Aqualad is Atlantean, and Aqualad's coming back in Teen Titans. So I thought that was just this great thing to just throw out there, that, you know what, not everybody reacts the same way to things that you do, and that, yes, Ron Funches is, his character, I don't know if they've given us the last name for his character yet, is Atlantean, and I hope that comes back later when they point out that Ron can breathe underwater.
that's the problem with that show. I wasn't sure if he was serious or if he was making a joke.
No, because they actually made a point that, dude, you're hating the show and you're still watching. That's good. You see, that's how we're going to get another season. Because you see the other Atlanteans react to him. He, like, gives them the fist, and they're like, yeah, man, Atlantean power, Atlantean pride. Because if you're an Atlantean, man, you're always dealing with those nonsense from the surface world. Surface world always literally keeping you down in Atlantis.
Yeah.
You know, I mean...
Let me just clarify. I feel like I should watch some of this stuff, even if I don't like it, just because... I'm a big Marvel and DC podcaster, but if I wasn't podcasting, think I'd be watching this? No.
Yeah, well, that's fine, man. I'm saying I love it, man. And I'll say, like, the last episode, and I watched it when I was half asleep. I can't even remember what the episode was about, the last episode. But it was really an episode that which I kind of felt was a little pat and kind of weak. But, you know, that was, like, the first one that I did not really enjoy, you know? So, you know... For what it's worth, that's pretty good. That's a pretty good track record. That, you know, for me anyway, you know, and like I said, not everyone is me. And honestly, I do not have a good track record of picking shows that the general public likes. But I'll say, show is pretty freaking genius. But that's me. Okay. Moving on from there. Interesting article given to us by my good friend Maz over at the Cage cast, a.k.a. Jessica Jones cast, the Gamma cast, although now it's mostly me and 80s music girl Rosemary. But he had posted an article about how there is this theory that the new film Life is a backdoor Venom film.
Yes, that's right.
And I was fascinated by that because, here's the thing. I just saw Old Man Logan. And you get the extended trailer before Old Man Logan. And honestly, when you see that thing, it looks a lot like Starro.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it doesn't look like a Venom, but it is this sort of every cell undifferentiated sentient organism. And I believe there is supposed to be something about it taking people over. So I do wonder, I don't know, like after Maz posted that, after we read that article, I'm sitting there saying, huh. It is produced by Sony. They do have the rights to Venom. They have said they want to do a Venom story. Are they going to make Venom the alien of Sony? Because let me tell you something. My son loves Venom. My son also loves Alien. This is my 7-year-old son, my little one. He is nuts. Love him, but he is nuts. He loves... and I won't say he's nuts. He's a freaking 7-year-old kid. He loves monsters, gaiju, and all this stuff. And we recently had a whole conversation about Jurassic Park, because now he's into dinosaurs, because he, like Steven Spielberg, recently realized that actually gaiju used to exist. That there used to be great monsters who roamed the earth. And, you know, I think that's very much what it was with Steven Spielberg, is like, you know, as a young man, he got very much into monsters and Ray Harryhausen. And then he, you know, learned that there were once dinosaurs that actually did walk the earth. And he created a show. And then, you know, for all honesty, Michael Crichton created this first. But, you know, it is this idea that, you know, there really were once monsters. There really were once these great and powerful beasts on the earth. This is essentially a death world we live on. You know, there's a great meme I just read about that. Basically, the idea that aliens should come to the earth and should conquer humans and then be completely destroyed by all the vicious monsters who live on our planet. But anyway, that's the whole thing. But the idea that this could be an interesting way to backdoor in a Venom outside of the Marvel Universe is a brilliant idea, especially because it gives you this great idea for weaponizing this thing they find, which gets you into Agent Venom, and then eventually what you might call a, because you can go through Venom as, because you essentially can start with Venom as the symbiote, go to an Agent Venom, go to Venom pure monster, and then come back to Venom in this more balanced role where he becomes the protagonist and the hero. So I think it's a pretty cool idea. I don't know if that's what they're doing, but I'll tell you what, if we talk about it enough, somebody may say, oh, shoot, that's a good idea. Let's go do that one.
Hey, and Deadpool's already up on that space station.
Is Deadpool on that space station?
Is that that's the one with Ryan Reynolds in it, right?
Oh, yes, he is. You're right.
Uh-huh.
They don't have rights to Ryan Reynolds. And, oh, man. Okay, so let's talk about Logan.
Yes.
We don't want to go too much because we are going to do a whole Logan cast, but goodness me, oh, my. Was this... You know, here's what I'm going to say. It's like Fox... You know, it's this interesting thing because right now Fox is in a really strong position because you went from... Well, okay, you didn't go right from Deadpool, which was this brilliant artistic triumph of Dadaist ultraviolence. But you go from that to Old Man Logan, which is just a pure Hollywood reverential piece of art.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't want to spoil it. There is this piece that... Oh... How much of a spoiler do you want in this, Phil? I mean, can I give a little tiny spoiler without giving too much to it?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead. I mean, we'll get more in depth later.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. So without explaining exactly what's happening, there is a scene where Charles Xavier is watching Shane, the old movie. Oh, brilliant movie. Brilliant book, actually. Probably one of the really great Western novels ever written. To give you an idea of how good it is, it's like one of the few they'll let you read in high school. Where someone says, oh, here's a book about cowboys and gunslingers, and you should read it. Shane is an awesome book. Probably one of the best. Honestly, anyone that likes cowboys as a genre probably read Shane. And I'm a guy who has yet to be impressed by most cowboy films, but is always hopeful because I love Shane as a book. And they do reference that here. And then here's the thing. Here's what is great. Cause there are basically two funerals in this film. Actually, no, technically there are three funerals in this film. But after the Shane scene, there's an opening scene where they have, them having a burial in Shane and they do the Our Father. Mm-hmm. And so for the rest of the film, I'm waiting for the, one of the future burials that we all know are coming to result in an Our Father. And when we actually get the callback, it's not the Our Father that they say. It's the last lines from Shane. And you're just smacked in the face like, oh, of course that's what they use. Because that's the relevant point for these characters. And that is just, I mean, it is so beautifully set up, so subtly introduced, so magically made as a film. Honestly, I mean, I don't know if Hugh Jackman deserves the Oscar for this, but an Oscar needs to be given out aside from a technical Oscar. A writer needs an Oscar for this, a director.
One of the actors has to get one for this.
Well, yeah, I mean, this would be a great time to give one to Patrick, I think.
Yeah.
You know, I think, you know, and let's face it, he's getting there. I mean, I don't know what his film work history. Well, no, actually, he was in Dune, and he was fantastic in Dune. You know?
And he did some of the Star Trek movies.
Well, he did do a couple Star Trek movies. But, you know, the Star Trek movies, the Next Gen movies were not...
Yeah.
Overwhelming.
But I'm just saying he has a little body of work in film.
Yeah, he does have a body of work in film. But this man, and he probably has a bunch more that we never think about. You know, that when they do the memoriam reel eventually, hopefully not for a very long time, but eventually when they do that, he does make the point he's a nonagenarian, not an octogenarian. you know, when they get to that, you know, there's going to be a lot of, it's like, oh yeah, he was in that. Oh yeah, I forgot he did that. Yeah, you know. But this would be a great time to give Patrick an Oscar. And honestly, I would love to see Patrick get an Oscar here. He's such a great guy. You know,
I mean, Hugh Jackman and Patrick Stewart, I mean, as they proved, you give them good material, they're going to hit it out of the park. They did a wonderful job. And you know who else impressed me? What's her name? Daphne Keene, the girl who played X-23.
That was exactly who I was going to throw out there. It's like, honestly, they could give her one of those little Shirley Temple Oscars, which Shirley Temple hated that she got because she was like, dude, I'm an actress. Don't give me a freaking kid Oscar. Give me a freaking real Oscar. She eventually got a real Oscar for a lifetime achievement. But no, Daphne was amazing in this. And honestly, I don't know. Daphne does not sound like a Spanish name, but she was rattling off those Spanish lines as if that was her native tongue. And when she cried, man, she got freaking snot bubbles going. And I got impressed by that. It's like, dude, I fancy myself an actor. I cannot cry on cue, no matter how hard I try. And this girl goes right to snot bubbles. And that's like, dude, that is like 18th level acting there. You know, you didn't see Patrick Stewart or Hugh Jackman doing no snot bubbles in this, but that girl can do snot bubbles right off the bat. That's impressive.
And just all the stuff she had to portray without using words.
Oh, yeah. No, and she does it magnificently.
And the fight scenes, you would think with a little girl, it might, might seem kind of corny or something. I bought it. I totally bought it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, honestly, stunt choreography, this thing gets an Oscar for it. No, hands down.
Yeah.
I don't think anything. You do that little girl doing a Black Widow, leg throw. Honestly, you know, how has Marvel not done a Black Widow film yet? I think at this point, I think the main reason thing keeping up Marvel from a Black Widow film is that Scarlett Johansson is like, yeah, you need to pay more for that. You know, I think Scarlett Johansson is like, look, I'm opening Ghost in the Shell. And anyone that saw the Ghost in the Shell trailer before this is like, oh, yeah, this is going to be the number one film. There's like not even a question in this.
Well, that's what I was telling them on This Week in Geek this week. I said, you know, if they don't want to do like a solo Black Widow movie or something, why don't they make a movie, or someone even said a Netflix miniseries with like the characters that they don't want to give their own solo, you know, have Black Widow, have Nick Fury, have Hawkeye.
Well, first off, because Scarlett Johansson is too big a star for Netflix.
True.
Well, then you know, I mean, that's the thing. It's like exactly. It's like Scarlett Johansson is too dang big a star here.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you do Sam Jackson too, again, too big of a star.
Well, no, I mean, I'm sorry, Sam Jackson is a pretty impressive older African American actor. But the fact of the matter is, you know, I mean, I'm not going to deny it. He is a great actor, but I wouldn't say he is so much of a star that, you know, you can't get, you know, he's one of the guys that did Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. because, you know, at the end of the day, first off, he's a workman and he says, I'm not turning down a paycheck, you know? I think if they said, let's do a Nick Fury film, Sam Jackson would be there yesterday. You know, because first off, Sam Jackson has never been given the opportunity to carry a film. You know, let's be honest here. Because you think about all of his major roles, they're usually either as the villain or as a guest star.
Mm-hmm.
He's never the protagonist of the film. You know, even Pulp Fiction, where you can say he's a co-star with Vinnie Barbarino. You know, he is actually just, you know, I mean, he is one of several other stories in that thing. You know, I would say you could just as easily say Christopher Walken is the star of Pulp Fiction, except that Samuel Jackson is more memorable, you know. But yeah, but I mean, and that's not to take away from Samuel L. Jackson. He certainly is a good actor, and he certainly is a character who, honestly, I think if you made a Nick Fury film, if you wrote a good Nick Fury film and put Nick Fury in there, had him chasing down, you know, had him basically as
James Bond.
No. Better than James Bond. He's James Bond who's too old for this. You know, he's basically the Danny Glover character.
Yes.
Playing James Bond, and which is actually the plot line to Predator 2. If you remember, it's Danny Glover, who's just too old for this, but he's like the one guy to actually walk away from Predator. He's like, no, because Danny Glover is just that cool. And that's what you would do with a Nick Fury. He's like, you know, I am too melon farming old for this, but let's go find another head, you know.
Do the MCU version of a Lethal Weapon with him as Danny Glover and bring in what's his face to play Hawkeye as Mel Gibson.
Yeah. Well, you know, but then again, you don't want to take away, you know, and that you got. You see, that's the thing. If you're gonna do a Sam L. Jackson Nick Fury, I want it to be just Nick. I mean, here's the thing. You could honestly. That's a great place to bring back Mockingbird and
Hunter.
So you have Nick Fury, pull in Mockingbird and Hunter. Maybe even get who is playing Dominic Fortune? Was that Ving Rhames, I want to say? Or who's doing Dominic Fortune in that? Man, I want to see that pilot. I don't know what people poo-pooed on it, but I got to say that's got to be great.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't think it was Ving Rhames. Isn't Ving Rhames dead? I'm not sure. But they got another, you know, bald, big black actor to play the role of Dominic Fortune, which sounded great when I heard it. And I really want to see it. I'm so sad that never got out anywhere. But, you know, that's the whole Perlmutter mess, you know. I mean, although for what it's worth, you notice that about the start of Logan. That's still Marvel Entertainment. That's not Marvel Studios.
Mm-hmm.
And you really get that differentiation now. It's like, oh, this is still under the comic book banner. But they did a great film. So, you know, I don't know where they're going. But I'm excited about it. Fox is not going to be giving back the X-Men anytime soon. Because now it's the irony. They figured out how to make it work, but they just destroyed their universe. You know,
mm-hmm.
You know, and the sad part is like none of the actors want to come back, so they have to do a reboot. So here's where they're at. They're at a point where they have to do a reboot. They're going to do a New Mutants reboot. The only other option they can do is they can take so Fox, here's your pitch. You ready? You just sent all of these young heroes, these young super clone heroes in 2029. Over to Canada. Who granted them asylum? Phil, who would grant a bunch of crazed mutant killers asylum in Canada?
Alpha Flight.
Yeah.
No.
So they get there. There's Ms. McKenzie in her Vindicator outfit, basically saying her name was McKenzie, right? Or was it?
Yeah.
I want to say it was McKenzie.
Yeah, I think so.
That's a typical Canadian name. Ms. McKenzie in a Vindicator outfit says, "Welcome to Canada. We don't want you to be killers. We want you to be heroes. Who sometimes kill? You know.
Hey, weren't they talking to some woman on that radio? They never revealed who that was.
I know. The lady who found Wolverine many years ago. Mm-hmm. And that is your thing. Don't do a New Mutants, Fox. Your next film is Alpha Flight.
Yes.
With X-23, Richter, and some other characters. Although I like the fat black kid with electro powers. He was cool. And you know why he's fat? Do you know why he's fat, Phil? Okay. Black. There was a Canadian. Okay, so I'm gonna go some deep dive here. There was a Canadian sci-fi show that was kind of wasn't a backdoor, but it was meant to be a pilot. It was called The Electric Eskimo, and it was this idea of this Eskimo kid who gained electro powers, but you know he had to have this calorie buildup to use electric powers. So obviously the fat kid's gonna have the electric powers because he has to have that stored up energy to burn. See? That's why he was the fat kid, because he had one of the most devastating powers next to Magneto Kid. I was actually waiting for Magneto Kid to pull the adamantium out of Wolverine there, you know, to save his life, but they didn't do that, and they shot him in the arm. But Magneto Kid was pretty cool. I'm assuming he was a magnetic kid because he dropped the truck on the evil Wolverine. It was cool seeing that was played by Sam Jackson. X-24 is played by Sam Jackson, too. Oh, not Sam Jackson.
Hugh Jackman.
They're stuck in the Jack section of my head, so pardon me.
Yeah. But I don't think that kid had magnetic powers. Didn't he use, like, the ground or something to pick up the truck?
I'm not sure. Maybe he was basically Terra. Maybe he was a Terra Kinetic. That's entirely possible. I'm not sure. Okay. But yeah, sorry. Oh man, we're spoiling the film. Sorry, kids. If you don't know, this is Super Connectivity. Sometimes there's spoilers. go back and not spoil yourself.
But yeah, stay tuned for another week or so. We'll have a full in-depth review.
Oh yeah. But so now you know there's a kid. There's Hugh Jackman playing two roles because he's identical cousins and, yeah, there's craziness, but it's an awesome film. Logan, it was number one, wasn't it?
Opening weekend, yes, it was. Yeah, and yeah. Then I think this last weekend it was number two because Kong beat it out on its opening weekend.
I liked Kong. I'll say that. I went to Kong and I really liked it. I know a lot of people are like down on it, but honestly, it's a great monster film. You know. If you like giant monsters, that's a film for you. And my son loves giant monsters. So that was, although you know what's funny? It was kind of weird because, you know, my son, my 7-year-old son saw Logan before I did. Cause, my one friend really wanted to see Logan, which I didn't know. And her son wanted to see Logan and my little son wanted to see Logan. So she took all of them to see Logan. And I was talking and I was telling my son, cause I know he likes Venom, that, you know, life is supposed to be a backdoor Venom film. And he was saying, oh, I don't want to see that. And you know why he didn't want to see that?
Why?
The hand breaking scene.
Ah.
That was too much for him. He's like, nope, not gonna, don't want to watch that. That's crazy. You're breaking people. You got fingers pointing in the wrong direction. I am not watching that.
Again, a spoiler, but I mean, weren't people getting decapitated in Logan? He didn't have a problem with that?
No, that's just, you know why? Because you get decapitated, you're dead.
That's true.
And the head's basically just a soccer ball at that point. The idea of having your fingers bent back,
as X-23 proved.
Yeah, well, you know, it's like, you know, it's a different thing. But it does show you the differentiation in violence, you know? That what makes violence strong is the fact that, you know, you live through it. Yeah. Violence that is quick is just quick, and you don't even worry about it. It's like, honestly, it's like when Deadpool laid on the shot guy, you know? Because we don't get a crossover. We don't get an end credit scene, but we get a pre-credit scene with Deadpool.
Deadpool, yes.
And, let's just talk Deadpool for 5 seconds. We get that. But, okay, there is so much graffiti all around there.
The phone booth.
Yes. So, two items. We see who's coming soon, Phil?
Nathan Summers.
And did you know what else was written in that phone book?
Oh, I might have missed it. No, what else was written?
Hope.
Oh.
We could get some time travel craziness going on with Deadpool. And I'm yes. hoping for it, man. Honestly, that is why I loved so much about Action Comics 975 this week over on the World's Finest reviews we did. Because mm-hmm. it was, their Mixoplex was so a Deadpool Mixoplex. It was like the best of Deadpool, the best of Ambush Bug, and just crammed into a little purple hat. And that is why Mixoplex was awesome there. It was great. And the idea that you might get Hope Summers, you might get Nathan Summers, you might get something completely different is really exciting. And, of course, all that is probably just teaser. But what I was going for is just this idea that, you know, when Deadpool goes to the guy at the end and he's been shot and he's still breathing and Deadpool just, like, chills out with him, it is so dark and disturbing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it, like I say, like, the violence that lasts longer is really the more frightening violence. You know, but anyway, Logan was just a fantastic film. There's no doubt about it. Okay, so let's move on to something else going on right now. Let's see. You sent me two articles. Okay, so Michael Rosenbaum is going to be in Guardians of the Galaxy, which is cool. Michael Rosenbaum, of course, played Lex Luthor famously on
Smallville.
Smallville. He also voiced the Flash on
Justice League animated series.
Yes. And he's done a few other things. He's a really good actor. We don't know who he's playing yet though. So it's like, you know, it's great that he's there, but it really depends on who he's playing, you know? I mean,
yeah. Well, you know what I didn't know that I saw in that article? Mm-hmm. I guess he was on the list originally for actors to play Star-Lord.
Oh, I could see that. I could mm-hmm. totally see him be that, like, you know, annoyingly sarcastic Star-Lord. I could totally see that.
Would have been interesting.
It would have been a different Star-Lord, because first off, he's in much better shape than Chris Pratt. You know, you know. Here's what I'll say. You know, that's the great thing about Chris Pratt. Even though he's like all cut now, you look at him like you are like two donuts away, aren't you, sir? You are two donuts away. You know, there was Richard Jenny used to do a bit about like guys how they see themselves and versus how girls see themselves. The girls would look in the mirror and they'd say, "Oh, I'm this, I'm that." You know, see all their flaws. But every guy looks in the mirror and thinks they're like two sit-ups away from being in a hot tub with Pamela Anderson to date it. You know, and that's the thing is like Chris Pratt definitely is a guy who is like, you know, he's two donuts away from not being Star-Lord. You know. which, no, not for nothing, he eats those donuts when he's not working. And you will see him on vacation with his lovely wife, who does the Unqualified podcast on a different network. I'm trying to remember her name.
Is it Anna Faris?
Yes. Thank you. Yeah. Well, you know, it is St. Patrick's Day. So,
Enough said.
Yeah, you know, hey, you know, it's St. Patrick's Day. We're all brothers in beer. You know what? But Anna Faris will post pictures of them while on vacation, and he's wearing his little red, white, and blue Speedo, and he's got his donut cut going. Because, you know, the man enjoys a donut, and I will not fault him for that. And God bless him that, you know, when the day calls and he has to get to work, he goes and does his sit-ups, and he is back. Now, the other article you sent to me was this idea that we're going to get a new Patriot in an uncanny, or not uncanny, but in the New Invaders. Brave New World introduces Marvel's New Invaders, and one of the characters we see on the cover is the Patriot. Now, there are some thoughts on who this could be. One thought is that it could be Isaiah Bradley, who has mm-hmm. been sort of lost in the universe for a while, and this is like a grown-up version of him. So maybe he's been out there fighting cosmic forces for a while and is now back. But there is another person this could be. And that is Elijah Bradley, the first Captain America, the African-American Captain America from Red, White, and Truth. who last we saw was in a sort of a, well, how would you describe his state? He was kind of like in a mentally degenerative state. Mm-hmm. But we have seen alternate universes where he doesn't enter that. And I've always wanted to bring that. I mean, for me, it's like, you know, I actually wrote, this is my crazy fanfic. I actually had this idea that, you know, you would do a Thor 1938 with, which we've crossed over a few times in the Invaders arcs with it. Which is that Thor gets conjured up by the Thule Society, of which Elsa is a member.
Oh.
And is fighting for the Nazis as a great warrior.
That's why he's not worthy.
Could be. Could be. And I actually had this whole idea of like this grand thing there, which was that, you know, because the idea, the basic idea behind my plot line was that basically Loki tricks Thor into going to serve the Nazis. Because essentially what you have is you have Loki, because he's a god of magic. You know, when Odin says, we shall no longer interfere with the realm of mortals, you have Loki say, but father, I am a god of magic, and the magicians still need help, and these are the heroes of their land. I certainly must aid them when they call. And so Loki gets that special dispensation to still be conjured when needed, which allows him to have his adventures with Venus in the 50s. Look it up, kids. You'll love it. But then he's like, oh, yes, Thor, they all call for you. They all wish you would come. Whenever they invoke me, they say, can you send Thor to aid us in our battles? Thor and his battles. And my idea was that that was the thing that caused Thor to be sent to be Don Blake. Was he served the Nazis, and he is, like, ready to destroy all. And then you have this nice subplot where, of course, the only guy behind enemy lines at that time working with the French Resistance is, of course, Isaiah Bradley. Now, I also had a little subplot in there that I always wanted to explore, which is the idea that Warrior Woman and Isaiah Bradley might have a kid. Because you have the opposites attract kind of thing, and they were both these super, these sort of failed super soldier serum experiments, but then they have a kid who maybe that's who the Patriot is.
Hey, you know what? It could even be Isaiah Bradley himself, because I mean, think about it. Kobik's in play. Kobik already de-aged Steve Rogers and reactivated his super soldier serum.
Oh yeah, and honestly, there you go. Honestly, maybe Bucky asks him to bring someone back, you know, bring someone that can beat him, and. Or, you know, I mean, there's anything possible. So Isaiah Bradley, I'm sorry, I'm going into my fanfic too much. Oh, Marvel, why don't you pay me, like, you know, $10 to give you a billion stories?
I think you said last episode, $10 and a six-pack, sure.
You know price. What? I'm going to waive the six-pack. There you go. There you go, Marvel. I'm priced to move. Isaiah Bradley would be a great option. I mean, I think it's probably Elijah Bradley. Because he is the last African American patriot we had, and he has been moved outside in the Young Avengers storyline. We had this thing where he got moved outside of reality for a while, and so this idea that he's been out fighting cosmic threats, possibly Kobik related threats for a while, and now he's back. Because, you know, we've got this other universe threat now.
So you don't think there's a chance at all that that's Sam Wilson?
You know, again, like I said, the reason I don't think it's Sam Wilson is he doesn't have wings.
Well, they've done this before. They could digitally alter that picture. Because, I mean, if you look at the picture, he has like straps like on his shoulders, but there's anything on his back. Could be holding something with wings in it, or maybe they took out the shield.
Yeah, well, don't forget, in the revamped 1940s Cap, he's got those same straps. This is actually very reminiscent of the 1940s Captain America outfit, which again speaks to Isaiah Bradley.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, I think that could very well be Isaiah Bradley, so which would be awesome to get him back. You know, there's another universe that the Fantastic Four visited where he is president of the United States. Of course.
How close did you look at this picture? Do you see what he's riding on?
Is he riding on something? Let me look here.
It looks like a.
Phil, you there?
Maybe a little.
Oh yeah. Okay. I hear you. Yeah, it looks kind of like a goblin glider.
Yeah.
Huh. Interesting. Well, politics makes strange bedfellows, and we do know that Osborne is sane now, and there's nothing.
I was going to say, Osborne's sane now, and if Steve Rogers considers him a threat, Norman might join the other side just for his own self-preservation.
Well, it doesn't even need to be, Cap sees him as a threat. I mean, Osborne may very rightly see Cap as a threat. You know,
Steve Rogers these days has shown that he's not afraid to kill some villains, so.
Well, yeah. Red Ghost, man? How do you take out the Red Ghost? He's a classic. absolutely. That's the thing. It's like these characters may need something better. So I could absolutely see, like I said in the roundup, I can totally imagine Otto turncoating on Hydra.
Mm-hmm.
Because we see Otto and Arnim being buddies. And let's be clear here. That's Otto and Arnim. That's two scientists talking. You know? Honestly, I was waiting for Arnim there to just say, you know, why did Warren never come to me to tell him how to make a clone? They're actually not that difficult. And Otto going, I know, I make some all the time.
Well, I mean, look what Otto's just done in the last few months. I mean, once he got his hands on that proto-clone, he double cross Ben Reilly in 2 seconds.
Exactly, man. Because he's gonna. Because he doesn't. He's got no loyalty to Hydra. Even in when he's like talking about, I'll hang out with Hydra for now.
He's Otto Gunther Octavius.
Yeah, I love that his middle name is Gunther because that's my dad's name. So it's like, yes, more proof of his superiority. Love my dad. He was awesome. Did not have octopus arms, though. But he was a butcher. So, they give us these teasers, Phil. And what are we supposed to do with them? You know, either we talk ad nauseum about them, or we just say, I don't know, could be anything. And it could be anything. That's the thing. Like, the Goblin Glider may have no reference to Osborne at all. But I do think that
They could have just stole it.
Yeah. Well, but you know, but I do think there is something to be said for that idea of strange bedfellows that, you know, because we already know there are these groups that are aligning against Cap and his secret empire. You know, we already know. And I wonder if Miles Morales is going to wind up killing Cap. You know, I wonder if that's the big denouement of it is that, you know, Ulysses was right. And when he went on to join the Elders of the Omniverse, you know, and I'm chomping at the bit to find out what the heck the Ultimates are going to be doing, man. It's like, you know, I'll tell you this much, man. These 2-week books are rough at times, but there are moments when you go, oh man, I wish this book was every 2 weeks. You know, because I wonder what's going on with the Ultimates right now. And Thunderbolt's on hiatus because they know too much. Oh, you know?
Yeah.
Because, you know, Jim Zub has all those books written, but we ain't going to hear it until they've already, like, said, and here's Secret Empire. Because Jim Zub knows too much. That's the problem. Okay, Phil. Anything else to talk about tonight?
No, I think that's about it.
Okay. Okay. Phil, if anyone wants to reach out to you, how can they find you?
If you want to talk to me about why Logan is one of the best Fox movies, you can always email me, nightwingpdp@gmail.com. On Twitter, I am @nightwingpdp. Check out all the other fine shows on the Enough Said podcast. Check out Before the Bat, Legends of DC, and World's Finest on the DC side.
Okay, and of course, you can always write to me in that old-fashioned email way at superconnectivityblog@gmail.com. That's super. ConnectivityBlog, all one word, @gmail.com. And, of course, follow me on the Twitters @CharlieEsser. That's CharlieEsser. Look for the 2 E's in the middle for quality. Thank you for connecting with us, ladies and gentlemen. Please connect with us again. Good night.